So for the spinal cord, there's gray matter and white matter. And just like with the brain, gray matter consists of the cell bodies or unmyelinated interneurons, whereas white matter is if made up of myelin, myelin being very fatty. That's where the terms come from. There's a dorsal horn, and then there's a ventral horn of the spinal cord. The dorsal horn consists of a lot of sensory neurons, okay? And then the ventral horn consists of a lot of motor neurons, as we're seeing illustrated by these picture here. Notice that this sensory neuron would be considered pseudo-unipolar. Or you could think of it as sensory being afferent transmission or the motor being efferent transmission. And one of the things that I really like about this diagram here as opposed to this is that this really does show where the cells are, where the bodies of said cells are, and all that jazz. One thing that I want you to think about is why we would be using an interneuron at these points. Why not just relay that information directly? And the reason is, or at least there's lots of explanations for it, but the reason that I think about it is that the more steps you have in any type of a signaling cascade, enzyme axis, whatever you want to call it, the more you can fine-tune and the more precise control you can have over something. So that's why I think that we use interneurons. There's other really good explanations as well, though. So all the same physical and then chemical protectants that we found in the brain, you know, cerebrospinal fluid, the meninges, a blood barrier, all that stuff is still in the spinal cord, okay? Your spinal cord is literally just an extension of your brain in terms of embryonic development, which I think we talked about later in this video series. But because of physical reasons, meningitis is a lot more clearly defined clinically in the brain and the spinal cord as opposed to that of the brain. Inflammation in the brain is kind of weird. It's not very easy to describe it because there's a lot of things packed up in there. However, when you have meningitis specifically, ask someone to put their chin into their chest and they can't do that. They can sometimes, if it's really bad, they can't even extend their legs out. Just because of the act of doing that puts so much pressure on the meninges. Okay, so for the embryonic development, I don't really stress this so much as just kind of fun facts so you can understand where this stuff comes from. So after 3 weeks, the ectoderm is going to start to thicken to form the neural plate over here, which means that your skin is more closely related in terms of embryonic development to your nervous system than the muscle is. That always threw me off so much. The neural plate here is going to invaginate to form the neural tube and then the neural fold, sorry, and then the neural groove. As we're seeing right here, the folds and the groove will eventually connect to form the tube, and that neural tube down here is what forms our central nervous system. Now, the stuff in green here is known as a neural crest. This is what becomes your the ganglii of your peripheral nervous system, and this is what we're seeing, this little thing here is what develops ultimately into your nervous system. Okay, so that neural tube is going to start to expand and constrict to form these things called primary brain vesicles, and then they're going to differentiate into the four main parts of the brain. And this organization is really nice for concept maps. I have had damage to my rotator cuff, and so I can't do concept maps, but I would encourage you to make your own. So neural tube here, primary brain vesicles, that gives rise to the forebrain, the midbrain, and the hindbrain, and all these things give rise to the telencephalon, the diencephalon, the mesencephalon, that should be that's a Greek word there, the medencephalon and the myelencephalon, and then ultimately the spinal cord. And this is really what we're gonna talk about for the most of these videos. So this is just those same things, just you know, in the fully developed human adult brain. And the diencephalon, the mesencephalon, meten, and myelencephalon, all of these things collectively consist of the brainstem, okay? The cerebral hemispheres, or the telencephalon, is everything else. Okay, so yeah, there's a lot of parts, but they're not all divided up based off of size and divided up evenly. So the first one that we're going to talk about is known as the myelencephalon, and this is otherwise known as the medulla. So right down here in that area there, and this place, obviously because of its location, carrying signals to and from the body and to the brain via these ascending and descending tracts, but it also houses the base of the reticular activation system, or sometimes called the reticular foramen. Anything with the word reticule like endoplasmic reticulum, the reticular activation complex. This was just means a net, a mesh-like structure there. It plays a large role in sleep, attention, motivation-type behaviors, but also has a lot of autonomic functions like heart rate, respiratory rate, muscle tone, coughing or vomiting, and these are kind of important. So if you ever drank too much, what happens? You vomit, right? Hopefully you've never seen this, but in people who have had just like instantly had a very severe brain injury, they will have projectile vomiting, okay? And it's not because there's poison in the body, like with, you know, drinking too much. The projectile vomiting that they're having is because they've had very severe brain damage and it is affecting their medulla. Another thing that you'll see with that's kind of indicative of really severe brain damage is called Kussmaul respirations. I'm gonna write that out just because this, so for vomiting, it is gonna be projectile and extreme head injuries. And then respiratory rate is something known as Kussmaul, where it has this kind of an unusual like interval where this speeds up really fast and then it slows down. The respiratory rate will speed up and then slow down. And then many other things as well, such as muscle tone. And this includes skeletal muscles. So as I'm sitting here talking to you, I'm not consciously aware of the fact that there are muscles in my body at any given point that are slightly contracted. That's something that's completely an autonomic function. So here's just a picture showing it, this being the reticular foramen, synonymous with reticular activation system, and then the medulla itself located around this light blue thing there. So the next one would be the medencephalon, and this consists of the cerebellum and the pons. Okay, so the cerebellum is incredibly important in precise motor function, processing information also from the cerebral motor cortex and proprietor receptors, and those are just things that tell the body's orientation in space. And it also might play a role in cognition. That's kind of a maybe at this point. Just for reference of how stupid I am, I spelt the word balance like this for like 3 years until a chemistry student was like, you spelt the word balance wrong. And the reason why I spelled it like that is because the cerebellum has two L's. And so I was spelling balance with two L's for like God knows how long. The pons, however, consists of also ascending and descending tracts. We'll talk a little bit about how that's really an interesting piece of circuitry. And it's also part of the reticular activation system or reticular foramen as well, which hopefully you can kind of see that in terms of location. This plays a large role with respiration rate and depth, probably has some other autonomic functions as well. That's just what the textbook listed. Mesencephalon, that term should hopefully look a little bit familiar. Anything with the word mesen means middle, you know, mesenchyme, which we talked about that, I think, in when we talked about the bones. The mesoderm as a layer of embryonic tissue, the middle layer, and now the mesencephalon is the middle part of the brain. And it consists of two divisions. There's the tectum and then the tegmentum. The tectum consists of an inferior and then superior colliculi. The inferior colliculi plays a role in auditory function. That's all I think that you really need to know at this part. The textbook didn't divulge much in detail on that. And then visual motor function, particularly for the body's orientation to or away from certain visual stimuli. The tegmentum is also part of that reticular foramen or reticular activation system, but it also contains something called the para-aqueductal gray, which surrounds the cerebral aqueduct, but mediates the pain-reducing effects of certain types of opiates. And I would be really interested in understanding the mechanism of that, because maybe then we could synthesize drugs that wouldn't have such, you know, long-term addictive properties, prescription drugs without addictive properties. It also contains the substantia nigra and then the red nucleus. And the substantia nigra is really important in terms of Parkinson's disease. This is connected to the basal ganglia, substantia nigra, connected to the basal ganglia, and this is part of the sensory motor system, so it plays a role in controlled movement. I'll talk about Parkinson's disease later. And then also the red nucleus, which is also a part of the sensory motor system, which communicates that motor information between the spinal cord and the cerebellum. Okay, so the next thing, last part of the brainstem is known as the diencephalon. And the two two structures that are important to this is the thalamus, and then lastly, the hypothalamus. So here we can see the thalamus right here, and then underneath it, very little bit, the hypothalamus. So there's a right and left lobe of it. It has these visible white bands that hopefully you can see right here. That consists, if you, anytime you see white, myelinated axon. And this plays a large role in sensory relay. And it's not necessarily just a one-way signal, but so as you're listening to me, or you know, as you feel something, or you hear something, or you smell it, that information goes, I'll just say, I guess sight as an example, that signal goes to the thalamus first, and then the thalamus is going to say, ah, this is a vision signal, I need to send this back to the occipital lobe, or this is a hearing signal, let's send this to the temporal lobe. And it's not just a one-way signal, it can send signals back and forth and things like that. The hypothalamus, we're going to talk a little bit more about that when we get to the endocrine lectures, but know that it's a neuroendocrine structure. It has both a role in the nervous system and a role in the endocrine system. In this context, really just works a lot with the pituitary gland, and I didn't mention it, but the pineal gland as well. And then for the neurological functions, plays a role in regulating motivated behavior, sex, eating, sleeping, and then as a relay point for the optic nerves, they're going to cross at that, so they have this term called the optic chiasm. Anything with the word X, like chiasmata or sorority, I think there's one called chi omega, that chi means X in Greek. Also contains a part of the mammillary bodies, which plays a role in recollective memory. Here's just a picture. There's a mammillary body, the optic chiasm, pituitary gland, and then the whole parts of the hypothalamus. We'll talk a little bit more about this stuff when we get to the endocrine lectures. Okay, so for the rest of this, we're going to talk about the telencephalon.